It's good to see you guys. See you all. I see the neon. It's great. All right. It's 5 o'clock. I may or may not have had makeup at 5:30. So I thank you for the music, DJ. I appreciate it. Dancing has really kept me together all day. And I get to really hang out with my, like, you guys are really giving me so much energy. I so much appreciate it. Yes, thank you. All right, so leadership and the path to get there is different for everyone, right? But there's one thing that always stays the same, which is, you know, career building and leadership skills, they're ongoing. You have to keep on learning. And that's what today's panel is all about, is really learning from other people's experiences and their paths. So with that, I will tell you about mine. Why not, right? Some of you know this, but I started off as a marketing specialist at a design build firm in Jacksonville, Florida. Where's my Jacksonville? It is crazy out here today, right? Okay, I'm sorry. Anyway, all right, back to my story. I worked at this design build firm. I was mostly, recruited because I was 22, and they were like, you're gonna do the social media. Perfect, you should do social media. So I was like, okay, cool, but what do I post? We need content. So I learned a lot at my first job. I learned about proposals. I learned about how to connect and talk to people, how to get what I need, or what I needed. I went to my first conference at my first job. I was like, oh my God, they're paying for me to go somewhere? And like, okay, this is awesome. And that was when I was like really overwhelmed, and I knew exactly what I wanted to do. I wanted to be up on that stage. But I still had my job, right? So fast forward, I kind of alluded to this in my first talk. My mom got sick. She had it. This is crazy. It's like a co-host. But my mom had this. She needed a liver, and she needed me to be her primary caretaker. Only child. Mom not remarried, so it's me. And so she got sick, and I told my company, I was like, hey, I really want to keep my job, but I have to move from Jacksonville to Atlanta to take care of her. And they were like, no, you got to be in the office, which is hilarious after the last 2 years. So I was like, okay, fine. I move home back with my mom. And I was looking for a job, could not find a job. Not nobody would hire me. I really tried. I went into interviews. It just never worked out. And when people think, you know, I have two entrepreneur parents. My mom is a psychologist, so she's all about the mind and being, you know, all of that. She's a great listener. And surprise, surprise, my dad is a speaker. He's Greg Gray. But once you see a picture of him, you'll be like, That is definitely Greg Gray's daughter, Danielle Gray, okay. But people thought that because my parents are entrepreneurs that I wanted to be an entrepreneur. And the truth is, when you have that, and it's that close, I was like, I don't want to live like, yo, this is crazy, right? It's up and down and all of this. But I got a call from my old job as I was looking for my own job, and they were like, how do I focus with this? Anyway, so I have my, that really threw me off of where I was. Anybody can tell me?
Your old job.
Old job, yes, old job, thank you. Old job called me, right? And they were like, so we're having a hard time replacing you. We haven't found someone that knows how to do social media, blogs, email. I was like, you see. But luckily, I built my business just because of them. They were like, okay, just come up with a company and we'll hire you. Great. They were paying me more that time, which was great. So I have this job, and or I have, you know, them, and that's when I was like, okay, I can't just have them as my only client. So that's when I looked up and I heard about SMPS. Now the crazy thing is, I did not know about SMPS when I was working at a design build firm for 4 or 5 years. I had no clue y'all existed. I probably would have stayed, but that wasn't my path, you know? And I found you when I was actually starting my job, or starting my company. And I remember going to my very first build business. It was in Philadelphia. And Kim Tompkins, I don't know if she's around here, SMPS Atlanta, she came up to me. And by the way, is she here? Okay, well, if you know Kim, okay, first of all, I am 6 foot. Kim is not, right? I was like, I don't know anybody. So she comes up and she talks to me, and I felt so, so much love. And that's when I really felt open arms to SMPS. They were like, sit at our table. I had never gone to SMPS Atlanta. I didn't do anything, but they just were like, no, you sit right here with us. And that was really cool. Fast forward, I joined the communications committee for SMPS. I did education committee, and that's where I realized, oh, they have programs. I can do speaking. This is my opportunity. This is just a little one, but I can do this. I don't mind being in any room, 5 people, 10 people. So I remember they had SERC, Amelia Island, had this opening call for speakers. And I was like, okay, I've been doing my networking. They know who I am. So I'm really hoping they give me a shot. And they did. My first presentation, Confessions of a Content Whisperer, which, by the way, was a direct link to my first company of learning how to deal with people and learning how to work with people. You know, I really took and embraced that moment once they told me, Danielle, we'll give you a shot. You know, that was huge for me. Then, what happened after that? I kept on talking. They were like, oh, anybody in here, were you at my first presentation? I'm just curious. That's so awesome. And you've seen it. You've seen the transition. You've seen the growth. And that's so cool. So I just kept on talking. And they were like, oh, yeah, Danielle, we like you. So I'm going around to other conferences and building my business and doing what I love and talking about what I love. And then I get a call, or I should say a email from SMPS headquarters, and said, in the subject line, it said, National Conference Host. And I said, what is this? My time is here. It was really, really cool. Really, really cool. So, and the best part about this email, so I'm like, oh, I'm about to kill her up. I'm about to be the host of SMPS. And they're like, also, can you ask your partner? I was like, I've been here. No, I was kidding, completely. No, but I actually thought, I was like, that is a brilliant idea. And it really has been. And I've had such a good time with that. So all that to say, that's my experience, is just hard work, seeing what I wanted, being very clear about where I wanted to go. And here I am. And I'm still going, I'm still evolving. And one day, hopefully, I'm hosting on even bigger stages in different places, but I always know where I started, and it was SMPS. So thank you for that. Thank you. All right, now, for what you've come to do and hear, because we learn so much from not just our experiences, but from other people's experiences, it's great to hear from, you know, everybody's journey. So we're gonna have this awesome panel of fellows to tell us how they got where they are. I mean, because fellows is like, I mean, that's top tier, you know? So to moderate our panel, we have Melissa Lutz, who, yes, give it up for Melissa. Yes, yes. And my co-host. So Melissa Lutz is a principal with the Champlin Architecture in Cincinnati. She's a past president of the society and an SMPS fellow. During her career, she has served on a variety of committees and board of directors, and she continues to volunteer for the Carnegie Art Center, where she donates her time to Suits That Rock, an effort that has raised over $1 million. I couldn't wait to say that. Thank you, Melissa, for that. For children's arts educational programs. With that, thank you for listening, and please, let's welcome Melissa Lutz.
Thanks, Danielle. It has been quite a journey, and I'm excited to get to work with you on this. Before we get started, because we're speaking about the SMPS fellows and other fellows, can everybody who's a fellow in the room stand up? Yay, congratulations. And for all of you who are here, at 7:45 tomorrow morning, you get to wake up and have breakfast in the Fellows Lounge, all of you Fellows, and hear from our task force about what we've been working on, and we want to get your feedback. So 7:45 Fellows Lounge, it will be the best morning you ever had, especially after tonight, I'm sure. So it is an honor to be here today, and I want to introduce three of my friends and esteemed Fellows. So we'll get started with Elizabeth Stolfus. She is a PE. She's a fellow of the American Council of Engineering Companies. She's president of Stolfus & Associate in Denver, Colorado, and she's my newest friend. We've been serving the last 2 years in an Elevate cohort for C-Suite. So welcome. The next one is V. Craig Galati. He is an FAIA, he's an FSMPS, and he's a CPSM. Woohoo! He's a principal at LGA Architecture in Las Vegas, and he's an author of several books, including his most recent one, The Reluctant Leader. So pick yourself up a copy on Amazon. And my next one is Beth Harris. We've known each other a really long time. She is the brains behind pushing to have the conference here in Atlanta. So woohoo, get a shout out for all the people from Atlanta and for Beth for making it happen. She's an FSMPS and a fellow of Society of American Military Engineers. Do we say SAM? People call it SAMe, but we say F-S-A-M-E, just in case you know, but everybody calls it SAMe, but it's S-A-M-E, just so you know. She's with Prime A&E Group, just joined, and she has continued to volunteer throughout her career for both SAME and SMPS. So let's all sit down and share about how being a fellow has amplified our lives. All right. For those of you who are our fellows or don't know about this, or know this, but a lot of you don't know that the SMPS Fellows represents the highest level of experience and leadership in architecture, engineering, construction firm, business development, and marketing. We are going to dive into these other societies and find out what a fellow means to their society. So let's get started. Beth, can you tell us what your industry fellow means? And tell us a little bit about what that means to your society.
Thank you very much. I'm going to read the definition of a fellow for SAME, the Society of American Military Engineers. The SAME Academy of Fellows are those who have rendered dedicated and outstanding service to the society, military engineering, and the AEC profession. You are to support the mission and strategic plan, be a role model, a mentor, and support your local post or chapter. In full disclosure, I'm not military. I'm not an engineer, but I went where my clients were, so that's how I got there. Thank you.
Awesome. What about you, Craig? Tell us about AIA Fellows.
So I would read the AIA definition, but it wasn't written by a marketer, so I'm just going to give you my best spin on it. So the College of Fellows of the American Institute of Architects was established a long time ago, 1800s. There's a lot of fellows over the years that have come through the AIA. The primary thing that a fellow is expected to do is to mentor and teach the next generation. In addition to that, the AIA also, the College of Fellows fundraises and established a research grant that's given every 2 years called the Latrobe Fellowship. So it's a really amazing thing. and a lot of really, really successful and really practice-changing ideas have come from that research grant.
Awesome, thank you. What about Elizabeth? Can you tell us about ACEC? What it means to be a fellow? And
absolutely, and not different from AIA. I think it doesn't make sense for me to share with you the full definition, but for my other ACEC friends that I've seen over the last couple of days, really, ACEC is the American Council of Engineering Companies and committed to consulting engineering of all types. As a fellow in ACEC, what actually happens is your local member organization nominates you. And that really happens not by yourself, but because of the people that you've come to work with and your growth as an individual in contributing to the industry. And it's two things. One, it's obviously a major honor, but also it's a new big commitment because what you're asked to do as a fellow at the national level is expand your influence on what comes next and to build a better community for engineering consulting companies. And, you know, there's so many ways that we do that, but really the big deal is step out of your comfort zone and move on to a place that is more connected with people you haven't met yet.
Awesome. Thank you. So I'm going to stay on you, Elizabeth. Tell us a little bit. This is the thing I was really curious about, and we all talked about a few times, is there's a lot of work that's been done, but there's a lot of work that still needs to be done in each one of our societies and associations. Can you tell us a little bit about that and what your role, what you'll play as a role as a fellow?
Absolutely. As I guess may be obvious in our worlds, as a female professional engineer, a lot of times I'm the only woman in the room or one of just a couple. And in my experience, that's been a pretty welcoming place. Obviously not always warm, but welcoming enough. Our community needs to do that better. And not just for women, but for everyone. And you know, as I look around this room today, where there are more women than maybe I have ever been around, I think it's important to keep in mind that we can't always see the things that make us feel like outsiders or like we don't belong. You know, in this room, I know that there are some other engineers, but you might not be able to pick them out. So some of the things that I can help with as a fellow is creating a more welcoming, more mature, more current environment for people to give their best.
All right, so Craig, tell us about AIA and what you're gonna do and what you need to do.
Well, first of all, I'm very proud to be a fellow of SMPS too. And I think of the fellowship in SMPS and this fellowship in AIA as connected. Because one of the things I think is so important is for architects to learn about marketing and architects to learn how to run practices. And there's so much work in the architectural field to teach what I consider basic things, but they're not taught to most architects. So I think that connection is what has been really, really important to me. But there are other issues. There are many issues in AIA. Climate change is an issue that we should all be working on, and the fellows have a great opportunity to talk about climate change, and not just the technical aspects of it, but the philosophical aspects of climate change, and how do we combat that, because it is happening. And the other thing in my profession, architecture, there's not enough people in the pipeline coming up. The kids are not going to school to be architects. And we need to encourage not just white boys to go to architecture school. We need to get people of color. We need to get more women in the architecture profession, or we won't have a profession. That is the future. It has to be, and it has to be diverse. And the more diverse it is, the better it will be. And I think there's a lot of work around that. And I think that's really what the AIA should be focused on.
Thank you for that. Beth, yeah, amen. Beth, can you tell us a little bit about SAME and what needs to be done and what you want to do?
Absolutely, thank you. Developing our future leaders is a large part of what SAME is focusing on now. We have what we call, of course, an acronym, LDP, Leadership Development Program. And the fellows are charged heavily with being involved in that program, helping to lead it. It's a year-long program. They pick one candidate from every region of SAME around the country and one international person to join it. But, you know, we have a lot of work to do. Of 800 fellows approximately at SAME, 13% are women. We've been working on that. We've been trying to make strides with that since 2010. I would say about 22% are women since 2010, which is, you know, that's a great improvement, but we have a long way to go. So, and proudly to make the link to SMPS as well, three of us are SMPS fellows as well as SAME fellows. So I would love to see that number go up. So if you're involved in federal work at your firm and you're involved in an SAME post, I would encourage you to consider becoming a fellow of SAME as well. Thank you.
All right. So now let's jump into what is your favorite thing that you've gotten to do since you became a fellow that you wouldn't have otherwise had the opportunity to do? Craig, we're going to start with you because I loved your idea.
So I became a fellow in AIA in 2019, and then we went through the COVID year, so it wasn't a whole lot to do. But the fellows committee in my state, there's only 17 AIA fellows in my state, so we're a small little group. But we have this committee, and I went to a lot of meetings, and their whole sole focus was who's going to be the next fellow. And I went, you know what, I'm not going to go to these meetings anymore unless we start doing something. That's why I became a fellow. And so because I said that and I spoke the loudest, I got tasked with doing something, which is kind of the way it works, right? So I'm really proud to say that this fall, we will be having the AIA Fellows Forum Series. And it is going to be in our state, and we're going to do four sessions around the business of architecture. It's not going to be about design. It's not going to be about construction drawing. It's going to be about how to run a practice. And we're going to have panels of our fellows. We're going to do two sessions in Las Vegas, two sessions in Reno, and we are going to simulcast them over Zoom to both places so that everybody can get this. We've invited the American Institute of students, AIAS is the student chapter. We were inviting them to come to it, and we hope we're going to get a huge turnout for all the young professionals and people that just want to learn how to run practices. And I'm going to also be on the marketing panel, so pretty. I got to hand select that one. So anyways, it's going to be fantastic, and I'm really proud of that because in my state, architects never, ever cooperate. And maybe that's in every state. But we're going to cooperate on this one, and it's going to be really good. And I'm very proud I had the opportunity to kind of push it forward.
I'm going to guess that happens in other states too, right? I'm sure. Elizabeth, can you talk a little bit about what you had an opportunity to do that you wouldn't have always had the opportunity to?
Absolutely. Because I'm an ACEC fellow, I had the opportunity to serve on the board of directors of the ACEC Research Institute. And I have to tell you, I learned more in that role than in so many of the other roles I have ever participated in. And not only that, I was exposed to thought leadership beyond my wildest dreams and some really wonderful people that I didn't have a direct way to connect with otherwise. And I can't tell you how impactful that's been to me, both as a person and in running my business. So that would never have happened otherwise.
Fantastic. Beth, tell us a little bit about what you've been able to do.
So I became a fellow of SAME in 2020. We are known as the first virtual class of SAME fellows. Sadly, there was a second one. We took our oath online. I have a picture of the screen of all of us raising our hands. So last October at the Small Business Conference, which was held here in Atlanta, was our first time to be together face-to-face. So our class of fellows, along with the 21 class of virtual fellows, met at a bar down the street from the CNN Center Hotel. And in our class, and this was just a small group networking event, in our class, And he was not in uniform, so nobody really recognized him. No name badge, no identification. Was Admiral Corca, who is head of NAVFAC. And if you do any military work, the Navy, NAVFAC is the engineering and construction end of Navy work. And he was just John that night. So we talked about wine and family and living overseas and picking olives out of his Tuscan backyard growing up or something. But to develop as a business developer, to be able to be in that small setting with those kinds of people as a fellow, I can't tell you how much it has impacted my career in the short time. And I've only been at two other fellows events at national events this year so far, but at every national event for SAME, we have a fellows event, a luncheon usually, sometimes a breakfast, where we're just together in a room and we sit at our tables and you never know who you're going to sit next to, but that kind of networking has been impactful, and I look forward to even more of it. It's amazing.
Thank
and
you.
Also, they call them fellows to serve, of course, because, you
fellows
know, let's ask the fellows to do it. So it's
yes.
also another great opportunity to serve the society.
I think it's another thing. When you have fellow after your name, it means you're not going to be done. You have a lot more to do.
Absolutely.
That's why
that
you sign
correct.
Up. Exactly. So for everybody who in the audience who is not an SMPS fellow or a fellow in their society, can you share maybe at what point you think they should be starting to consider this and some things to look out for or to start striving for?
Absolutely. Another thing you get to do once you're a fellow is to serve on a fellows, Academy of Fellows jury or panel where you are reading through applications and selecting the next fellows. And that SMPS does the same thing. The first thing I would say is read the application to make sure you check all the boxes, because the jurors are looking for a reason to disqualify, just as clients read proposals to look for reasons to disqualify. So I know my personal experience in both SAME and SMPS, I really was not thinking about becoming a fellow. I wasn't on my radar, but my peers reached out and they knew what I had done. And in both cases, I was heavily encouraged by my peers. So if you're even thinking about being a fellow or curious or want to know more about it, talk to a fellow. We love to encourage people to do it. That's how I did it twice. So feel free to reach out and ask questions or just call us to pick our brains about it. That's what we're here for.
Absolutely. And anybody would jump at the chance to help somebody else achieve that, I think. So reach out. And then Craig, how about you?
Well, I think the first thing is get your mind right on why you want to do it. It is a call to service. It's not just the recognition. And if you're not ready to serve, maybe it's not the right time. You'll know when that time is right because others will be encouraging you. I remember when I got my CPSM in 2014, and I was very proud of that. Worked really hard to do that. And some of my friends said, well, now you can be a fellow. You should go be a fellow. So I tried for that. I got my fellow and my CPSM at the same Build Business Conference. But I did it because I was encouraged. And the AIA one, I was very, very active earlier in my career in AIA, and not as much lately, but I finally agreed after a lot of my colleagues said, you need to get your fellow. And what I think it meant to me was it gave me a better platform. It gave me a better place to teach and to coach. And the recognition of it allows that to happen, but the fact that the fellows are there to serve makes it happen. So be ready that you want to do that, and talk to your friends that are fellows in whatever organization. And I would say that, like I say, be ready and talk to people and understand what does it really mean. Because we do need more fellows. This society, and other societies. We need more people because we got a whole lot of work to do. We got a lot of young people coming up that got to get trained right, and they need to be mentored, and we need the next generation up because many of us fellows we're not that young anymore. So let's bring that next group in.
All right, Elizabeth.
Well, I just add to that. Volunteer where you are. Be where you're at today and keep saying yes. Everything I've said yes to in my career as a volunteer has given me more than I gave. Everything I've said yes to has made me better. And it's also helped the organization that I was working with. I think that's a really important part. And so as you go through and do everything you can at your local level and in your local chapter, keep thinking about what more you might be able to do. And then you'll know that you're ready to be a fellow because there's so much more for you to give and so much more for you to receive.
Thank you. So we need right now your final words of wisdom. Beth, tell us your final words of wisdom for those who want to be a fellow or just about being a fellow in general.
I'm just going to take the business developer mindset and say, go where your clients are. I mean, it just makes sense. Your company will probably support it better, and you will grow from it. And when you can serve alongside your client and become friends and build a personal relationship, that just strengthens all of the business relationships. And then, you know, there are marketers that are fellows of other societies besides AIA, ACEC, I mean, DBIA, CMAA. There are plenty of other organizations where you can become a fellow. Or certainly SMPS. I mean, start here, please, because we need you to do it here, too. But we build bridges to other associations and societies when our fellows become those fellows as well.
Craig, your words of wisdom.
Words of wisdom. I would say that your friends will encourage you to be a fellow. And when they do, they're doing it out of love. They're doing it out of support for you. And listen to them. I know many of us don't always listen to it, but we all have to be pushed. We have to be pushed into these things a bit. And I think being a fellow, one of the best things about being a fellow is that you get to talk to other fellows all the time. And you get to go to fellows education sessions and fellows hosting parties and fellow lounge and all that stuff. But the smartest people you ever want to meet. And you can always continue learning and continue growing. So that's just another step in this long journey we're all on.
Elizabeth?
I think you've probably heard this a lot this week, but be yourself. I think that it's really important that we be ourselves. All of us are needed to create that future that we all have a glimmer of in our imaginations. And when we do that, it makes us stronger. And if you're wondering, why would I be myself nationally instead of just in my state? The answer to that question is, where else are you going to find someone more like you, more able to help you in the next steps than if you make a bigger pool to look in? And by the time you become a fellow, you'll be completely ready to make those new relationships and grow from them and implement the things that others have already learned that will bring you forward on the path and, meanwhile, make a better place for all of those folks that will be entering our profession in the coming years that haven't yet had a glimmer of our world and don't know what AEC is yet. But when you be yourself and keep going, you'll be giving them the inspiration they need to be themselves as well.
I love that theme of the UBU. We're gonna keep elevating that theme and amplifying it. So thanks to all of you for doing this. Everyone loves to end one part of this early, so we're gonna roll into the next part, but can I have a round of applause for our fellow panelists? Thank you. Thank you to all of you for sharing your valuable insight and the important role that our fellowship programs play in our personal and professional growth. Now is the perfect time to talk more about the SMPS Fellows Program and acknowledge the incoming class. As we said earlier, SMPS fellows represent the highest level of experience in leadership and business development and marketing in the AEC industries. They also serve SMPS as a resource, providing insight, ideas, programs, and of course, mentoring for our members and the professional community. Before we honor them, I'd like to recognize all of our fellows here in the room. We did that earlier, but hey, another shout out for every fellow in this room. So woohoo to all of you. Woo! Each one of you is an ambassador for the society, our members, and all of our industries, and I thank each and every one of you. This year, we have 9 new fellows, and I'm honored to be able to congratulate them. Without further ado, let's hear from the 2022 Class of SMPS Fellows.
My name is Leah Boltz. I'm a Principal of Marketing, Business Development, and Community Outreach for Bettesworth North Architects and Planners in Anchorage, Alaska.
Anne-Marie Funk, Marketing Strategy Manager at ADG Blatt in Oklahoma City.
Catherine McCullough, President, CEO, and CMO of McCullough, a landscape and urban design firm located in California.
Hi, I'm Ann Fiola. I'm Senior Market Analyst and Growth Leader at RSNH.
I'm Megan Scott, the Director of Strategy at Etica Group.
My name is Paula Stamp. I'm Vice President for Economic Development for Clayco Company.
Hi, my name is Courtney Van Ostrand, and I am the Director of Marketing and Business Development at Tech Inc. Engineering and Design.
Joy Wu, Director, Urban Land Institute.
Kurt Yoshi, Principal Engineer, Nino and Moore.
In one word, the SMPS Fellows means to me, elevation.
Leadership.
Inspiration.
Trailblazer.
Impact.
Curiosity, mentorship,
inclusion,
giving back.
Congratulations again to the 2022 Class of Fellows. Continuing with leadership and excellence, please welcome to the stage my friends Carolyn Ferguson and Tom Smith, the 2020 and 2021 Weld Coxe Marketing Achievement Award recipients. And joining them is SMPS past president, Doug Parker.
I'm going to pull the mic down just a little because it was really high and I'm not that tall. Anyway, thanks so much. And thank you, panelists, for all of your great wisdom. That was such a great program. And Melissa, you did amazing. You know, Tom, it feels like forever since we've been together, like 2019, right?
Right, because it has been. And it's so great to be in person again. Since we weren't able to officially share the stage to accept our MAAs from 2020 and 2021 in person, I'd like to give a shout out to those behind the scenes for making this happen and allowing us to be together today.
Right, and we have some unfinished business, and I already checked with our winner this evening, and we are going to officially pass the trophies to each other.
Well, thank you, Carolyn.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. That feels wonderful. It's an honor to be here for Amplify AEC and an honor to recognize this year's accomplishments of the Weld Coxe Marketing Achievement Award recipient. Before we announce this year's recipient, a little bit about the honor. The Marketing Achievement Award recognizes a marketing professional and leader for exemplary career achievements in the areas of research, education, professional leadership, and marketing communications, as well as innovative programs and for lasting contributions to the industries.
And as some of you may know, Weld Coxe was a pioneer in the field of professional services marketing, a founder of SMPS, and the second recipient of the Marketing Achievement Award. 30 individuals have been recognized to date with this award. This year, we honor the 31st and celebrate the achievements of this most deserving honoree. And now the 2022 recipient of the Weld Coxe Marketing Achievement Award is, drum roll, Barbara Shuck. Congratulations, Barbara.
Longtime leader, marketing master, inspiring innovator. For more than 25 years, Barbara Shuck has made a huge impact in the AEC industries. She's a marketing and business development veteran, instructor, and industry speaker. A powerful leader who champions innovative ideas to advance the goals of all the firms and organizations she serves. And that includes SMPS. Throughout her career, she has served 22 consecutive years of active SMPS volunteerism, 7 years on the Society Board of Directors, 4 years as SMPS Foundation Trustee, and 2 chapter president roles at SMPS Arizona and SMPS Nebraska. Her dedication and commitment are unwavering. Barbara is passionate about her career and creating opportunities to advance the AEC profession. Her philosophy is learn, do, master, teach, which is evident by the 2,000 hours she spent delivering best practice content through workshops, chapter and conference programming, university sessions, and articles. On the mentoring front, Barbara discovered a passion to support marketers early on and continues mentoring to help others succeed. Storytelling is another passion of Barbara's, and these days, she helps AEC marketers understand how to use proven storytelling techniques to stand out, win work, attract employees, and grow their firms. Barbara's contributions and commitment to SMPS and to the profession are monumental. She lives by the mantra, "Go beyond," inspiring every professional she meets to go beyond and be the best they can be. Longtime leader, marketing master, inspiring innovator, Barbara Shuck, the 2022 Weld Coxe Marketing Achievement Award recipient.
So, Barbara, if you would, please join us on stage. So this year, we're going to do something a little differently. Have a seat, my friend.
Thank you.
So I am very honored to have the opportunity to spend a few minutes talking to my good friend, Barbara Shuck. You know, it's, Barbara, we've been friends for a long time. And all the words that were just said about you are just, I've lived a lot of them with you, and the one thing I think was missing was smartest person I know. Yeah. And so, right? And anyone who's worked closely with you knows that. You know, when we were, Barbara and I were preparing for this, and we were talking about we've known each other this really long time, we have had many conversations just like this, sitting on a couch at the Kempton Hotel in Alexandria, Virginia, for some service of some kind in a meeting, usually at 3 or 4 in the morning. Sometimes
my husband's here.
Oh yeah, sorry, Jerry. I mean, 3 or 4 in the afternoon. Sometimes with a glass of wine.
Most of the time with a glass of wine.
Always with some tissues.
Yeah.
But it's been, I mean, those conversations have been some of the most wonderful in SMPS for me, and I think because of our friendship. So thank you so much for that. We're not going to solve the world's problems today, but we are going to dive into a little bit about you and a little bit about this journey you've been on and the many, many contributions and all the things that have brought you to this wonderful achievement. I am so proud of you and so happy for you, and I know that is shared with so many of us here. So let's start off talking about Weld Coxe. Neither of us knew him, but we know about him, and we know what he did and all the things that he did for SMPS. So I would love for you to talk a little bit about Weld Coxe, what it means to you to receive this award, what it means to like be sitting here right now in front of your peers, you know, at this special time.
Okay, three questions. I can only remember one at a time. But anyway, so Weld Coxe was, he started our profession. He was the one who invented the marketing coordinator. And I have a little bit of a pack rat kind of personality, but I found the marketer from August of 2011 when, and it featured him, a beautiful, beautiful article and quotes from some of you, and the story of Weld Coxe, because he had passed away that year. And I'd always heard about him, and in all of my career in the industry, and probably have some books, and just hear, you hear about these legendary people who had a vision, who started out at Harvard. He left after a couple of years, and he became a journalist. Yay, writers, yay. And he got into our industry, and he said, we need people who can understand the business. We need people who can write, can pull all these things together. And he saw this need for people, marketing coordinators in our profession. And so before him, do you realize that our profession didn't even exist? It was illegal to have marketing in the 60s. And so as the laws changed and we had people like him to set this vision and create a profession for us, we wouldn't be sitting here today. I wouldn't be sitting here today if it weren't for somebody like Weld Coxe. He was actually, they introduced him, he was the second MAA winner. He was member number two. And so I encourage us to look back, to understand the lives and the impact of people who have set the stage for who we are, so that we can have a forward motion and we can build this career for the future, for generations, you young people who are here, so that there are pathways for success, that there's pathways for growth and development, that we can have all kinds of people enter our profession and have an impact on the firms and the built environment. So he was a revolutionary, he was a visionary, he was a mentor, and he is everything who we want to be in a wonderful human being. And he is a guiding light for us, and we should know more about him, and we should honor him through his actions and his words. We need to understand how foundational he was to the profession that we love. That was question one.
That was question one. We may be here a little while, which is great. You know, so thinking about Weld Coxe and this award and all the things he accomplished and all the things he did for society, I'd love for you to share a few lessons learned from your own professional journey and maybe one or two things that you think are impactful that you can share with our audience today.
Oh, gosh. Lessons learned. Okay, this is a long time. We've known each other a long time, but, you know, you go back almost 30 years, really. You know, it's the memory gets old. But lessons learned are, you know, asking questions when you don't know something. And for me, this wasn't my first career. I was in the printing business before this, and I didn't know the industry. And I started in the construction side of things, and so I had to learn to ask questions that were really dumb and understand that, you know, I was gonna take all the kinds of guidance and comments and all kinds of things that I would have to endure. This is going the wrong direction, but that I would have to learn to have thick skin, that I would have to learn to be
open to feedback and being able to ask questions of really smart people so that I could help them win more work and be successful. So asking questions is really important. Being curious is important. Again, my husband says feedback is a gift, and I think that's one of the most important things that I've learned over time, is there's always something that we can learn from feedback, even the really tough stuff. We might get into that, but when somebody gives you feedback, there's all kinds of things that you can do with it, but when you look at it as a gift and there's an opportunity there, then it's a lot easier to look inside to find some power, some nuggets, mine the nuggets of experience so that you can become a better human being on the other side of it, not just do a better job, just becoming a better human being.
So speaking of feedback, I'm gonna go there. You ready?
It's a gift.
All right. So you shared with me once that you got some feedback that was a little hard and a little critical, which is crazy because that feedback was you're too passionate.
You're just too passionate. That was what he said.
I would love for that to be the worst thing ever said about me. No comments. How have you embraced that feedback? Because I know that it was hard, right? I mean, what a horrible thing to someone say that you'd have too much passion. But how have you dealt with that? And how have you come to understand that that really is one of your strengths?
It took a while. It wasn't easy, and it was one of those dips in the road, the peaks and valleys kind of moments. And it was really hard to hear you're just too passionate. I worked for an engineering firm at the time, and it cut to the core. I lost all my mojo. I doubted every single thing that I had ever done at the company, ever word that I'd ever said or anything like that. And fast forward, he did some surveys with some of the employees and got feedback from them and gave me less than 24 hours to go through with these comments of people and then have a meeting the next day, which meant that, of course, I pulled an all-nighter. But it was so difficult to hear him on this platform of you're just too passionate and get this feedback from these colleagues. And I mean, that night there were tears, there was prayers, there was probably some screaming. And it was just like, how do I take all of this and make some sense out of it? And that was when I developed my little buckets. And I know some of you have heard it before, but when I got that feedback, I had to navigate through it so that I literally could live on the other side of it. And there's lies, logistics, and learning. Lies are the things that people had said that was their truth, but it wasn't my truth, and there would never be a common interest, that we could never get there. So I could put the lies, their truths, into a bucket, let it go. In the logistics part, it was kind of like, yeah, there's organizational issues. Yes, there's a solution. Yes, we can do something with this. And I'd love to work on it. Let's collaborate on it. Let's talk about it. It's something we can do. And then the third bucket was, there's not a darn thing I can do about this other than embrace this feedback, this gift, and become a better human being because of it, because it was very personal. So that was one of those moments where you're taking this awful, 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 awful situation and developing some kind of tool in the toolbox so that I could navigate through it. And through my friends, lots of probably more wine and conversations and plenty of tears, but it was through this group of people that you helped me find myself again. And it was a therapeutic type of a process, but I learned that you're just too passionate. It be me. It is who I am. I love my job. I love what I do. I can't help it. So I had to leave so that I could find a place where I could be me and have my passion would be a driving force that could make me be happy and successful. So in all of that, there are these downtimes. I lost every ounce of confidence that I had. And I had been in business in this industry for a long time. And through the help of my friends, through the help of a lot of deep, deep introspection, you know, I could take it and build on it. And it was navigating up a very steep hill, and I do feel like I'm on the other side. It's Everest marketing. That's why it is that way. It's the high top, you know. So there's paths you can go.
Yeah, you needed Danielle's talk yesterday, Ben.
Which is why you need to write the book, do the podcast, all the meditation that we should.
That too. Right. So, switching gears a little bit, your SMPS story is a little bit unique. I would love for you to share that, how you found us and what hooked you in and just what your journey was.
Well, at the construction company, the vice president of marketing, practically the first day, said, you're going to join this organization, but you're not going to let anybody recruit you, but you have to join the organization. So, and that was in Wichita, and it was a city that did not have a chapter. Go Wichita, you have one now. But at the time, my first experience with SMPS, I went to the national conference. It was in Chicago, and I think we were talking about it. Tom Peters was a full-day keynote, and he walked around and tables, and it was amazing. But my only personal experience, networking and all that, was the national conference. And we got a magazine. It wasn't as nice as even this marketer. And this is a previous addition to what we have now. And I think there was a website. I'm not sure. That was my SMPS experience. But there must have been something about it that it was enough, it was good, I was learning things, and I've got the t-shirt, everything I learned was in SMPS. And so then I moved to Arizona, and shortly upon getting there, I found out there was this thing called an SMPS chapter. It's like, what? You know, and so I went to the chapter meeting, and probably like some of you, I walked out as the education chair, and that was the first path on leadership. And then when I moved, got very involved in Arizona and then moved to Nebraska, and I don't have any family in Nebraska or anything. So who are my first friends? SMPS Nebraska. And so SMPS has been lot different, no chapter, big chapter, middle-sized chapter, all different kinds of experiences. And the commonality, the thread is SMPS. It is the programs. It is the network. It is all the learning. It is lifelong friends that they're friends, not just people that I hang out with because they're in the same industry. So it's been lots of different SMPS has been a common thread when I've moved in different kinds of relationships that I've had.
So present moment excluded. Do you have a very favorite SMPS memory?
Well, I have a lot of memories. Some of them we won't be talking about.
It's because Jerry's here.
Yeah. So you guys have to be really nice to him tonight and don't let him all know all this other stuff,
right.
The secrets. Remember, we're all friends. I don't know. There's so many, but I think probably they're combined together is, and I do a lot of speaking, as you well know, and I love, it isn't me talking and I have to do less of that. It is sharing ideas so that somebody learns something and has a new idea. And in various training and programs and with younger members, newer members to the profession, the high points are when I can see a spark. It's like, ah, oh, now I know how to do that. Now I get it. And that is those kinds of memories when you see somebody learn something new that's going to make a difference in their job and their companies and their joy in life. That is what really, those are the ones that I really cherish the most.
So, in your video, there was a recap of this crazy, amazing career and accomplishments and, you know, 25 years, 8,000 people that you've spoken in front of or to, 160 presentations and programs. I mean, it's impressive and it's a lot. And I know you love it. And I love that your like favorite memory was a moment like that where you see someone get it. And it wasn't about you, it was about them hearing and interpreting and doing something with it. So all of that work you've done, is there anything that stands out as like something you've learned while you're teaching?
Well, I've learned that I don't know nearly as much as y'all do when we all get our heads together and have a conversation, brainstorm, round tables, ask a question in a presentation or something like that. I am working hard on improving my training skills. And one of the things that I really am learning, trying to embrace is you're not the sage on the stage, you're the guide on the side. And that the audience actually starts learning when the speaker shuts up. And kind of hard for me sometimes, but it's true because I can only talk so much. You all have to think, you have to process, you have to apply it, you have to discuss it, have small group exercises, have brainstorming, have flip charts and dots and all that kind of stuff. But that's what I think is the coolest thing that I learn is when somebody asks me a question, it's like, I never even thought of that. Well, let's think about it. Let's talk about it. What is your experience? How does your firm do it? And those are the kinds of things when, like, you know, maybe you see light bulbs spark above my head too, because, you know, nobody knows everything, but all together we can know an awful lot together, and that's what is really fun.
Right. And I love that Go Beyond is such a part of your life, and Everest is such a part of your life, and I think it speaks to that so much. So learning is continual, right? We're always learning, we're always evolving, we're always growing, hopefully. Stagnate or die.
Mm. Or,
the other way around. Change or die. So what's something that you're still working on, or maybe what's next for you, like from an aspirational standpoint?
Well, it is the training. It is sharing insights so that I talk less and people learn more. I want young professionals to mentor me. I want to understand a young person's, in 2022, your view of the world is not my view of the world. I want to understand that because that's the future of our profession. That's the future of the built environment, design and construction. So those are what I want to keep looking for, is where can I learn more about how a different person thinks so that it can help our firms be successful and help really humanity because of the impact that we have. So I don't plan on retiring, certainly anytime soon, and I want to stay relevant because I'm hearing things that are really important and challenged an older person's way of thinking, because you know, Weld Coxe is great and everything, and we need to honor them, but we need to move forward, too. We need to understand the past so that we can have the future, and I want to be part of the future. I don't want to be, you know, sitting on a, laying on a sofa, you know, and being not relevant anymore. So I think that's what is exciting to me. And I got to tell you guys, when the more I meet old people, too, but young people...
don't look at me when you say that.
I know. When I meet you young people that have so many passions for things beyond our profession and, you know, collaborative thinking, things that Elizabeth was talking about, things that Beth and Craig were talking about, it's like, oh my gosh, the future of our profession is through the young people who are going to be coming up, and we've got to find them. We have to bring these great minds into the thing that we love. We have to go out to the universities and tell them that this profession exists. We have to find opportunities to provide scholarships and opportunities for people to learn. They're not going to study us. None of us studied this. We fell into this. We've got to find ways of attracting people. We put magnets in all of our everything that we do so that we really attract people. But we've got to grow our profession because it's amazing. And there's so much opportunity for young people to contribute to the future technologies, to future ways of thinking that we can't even think about right now. And so that's where I see 5-10 years from now. I want more of that so that we can continue to accelerate the path that we're on.
Fantastic. So you said, when you were just talking, you made a comment about like just hearing really great things, is aside from the conversations we have had, is there any one really great piece of advice that you've been given that has stuck with you?
Well, two things that the man who brought me into the industry, Gordon Lacey, he had been with Kiewit, and he was a marketing vice president of marketing. And you know, besides join SMPS, but don't let them recruit you. He had on his desk, it's a little sign. It says, lose not thy cooleth. And I love that because, and he could be kind, he could be very persuasive and very opinionated. You know, Gordon was passionate. He loved what he did, so bless his heart. He died a couple of years after I met him. And he was, I was telling somebody today, he was an only child, never married, never had kids, a very solitary adult. And when he died, he didn't have any family or anything. His parents were still alive, but they were elderly. And so he let executive assistant, me, marketing coordinator, and the safety manager for the company go through his belongings, and we could pick out stuff. He was a great cook, so I picked out cookbooks. We picked out all the things that we wanted from his home, and it was so amazing. But I wanted the little sign that was on his desk, lose not thy cooleth, because it helps me remember to keep my feet grounded and try to keep my head on straight. Second thing that he said that was really good is, you're good at your job and all that, but on some days you don't have to give 100%. Some days your 80% is going to be better than most other people's 100%. And if you only have 80% to give, that's okay. So that really has helped me in deadlines, family, kids, all the kinds of things. Sometimes your 80% is absolutely going to be enough. And I think we all need an 80% day from time to time.
Absolutely. So there have been many, many people who've been part of your journey, played a big part in your professional and personal life. Many of them are here. I would love, as we close, to give you the stage and a little time to speak to them.
Yep. Thank you.
You're welcome.
So I do have some, notes. And a lot of words are on them. I know.
Just get this for you now.
Yeah. I'm doing good. So I'm really humbled to be on this couch. And I've given him a pretty hard time about it. You know, I've done a lot of stuff. And it's kind of fun to see it. It was interesting. The faces and all those pictures, all those people. And this was probably the hardest submittal proposal that I've ever done because my team kept pushing me to go beyond, keep pushing. What's the value? What's the impact? What's actually going on here? And it was very introspective. And I learned a lot, not just about myself, but also about the Nebraska chapter, the Arizona chapter, all the different organizations that I've been in. And it was really a trip down memory lane, but it was like, wow, this is pretty interesting how dots connect and how important it is. I've learned that I've done a lot of things, and I'm hopeful that because I've done a lot of things, someone else has benefited. That you've learned something, you've had a chance to do something that you've never done before, or that you've used a nugget to launch something amazing in your career for your firms, or personally for yourself. My career isn't yours. I can honestly look back and see all the mistakes and all the junk that I've done, and I forget to see the blessings. My career doesn't define me, but it is very important to me. So my personal vision is to glorify God through faith, family, friends, and work. I'm so lucky, I'm blessed, that most of my friends intersect with my work life. I don't have a real good separation there. For my entire career in the AEC industry, SMPS has been here for me from the first day. I intend to be here for SMPS for a very long time to come. So, and I will stand up. So, I do want to thank some people. I want to thank the three people that helped me with the submittal. Two of them are here. Melissa Lutz, Carolyn Ferguson, and Ann Seibert. And Ann's an old friend from, a longtime friend from Arizona. Y'all pushed me so hard. You helped me so much. You read through lots and lots of words and lots of different, all the things, and really helped put it in perspective that was really good for me and that it is something that's important for our industry. Not every day was a particularly cheerful one. And there were, but you were constant encouragers and challengers to make it better, to really go beyond. And I thank you for that. I'm a better human being because of your work and this submittal. So thank you very much. You are dear friends now and forever. Let's give them a hand, please. So some others of you have been coaches, mentors, friends. Craig Park, Paula Ryan, Frank Lippert, Kevin Hebblethwaite, Brad Thurman, Carla Thompson, Donna Corlew. Very, very close friends, people who I've relied on and who have gotten me through lots of those low times. Sometimes with wine, sometimes at 2 o'clock in the morning, get it. Former board members when I was on the board. Donna Jakubowicz, Judy Nitsch, Tom Smith, Holly Bolton, Tom Towns, Doug Parker, Craig Galati, Don Savage, Chris Rickman, Nancy Ustry, and then with the foundation, Andrea Goodwin, Janet McCauley. You all have inspired me, challenged me. You just make me a better person, and I truly appreciate working side by side with you. We had a foundation meeting on Monday for the next year, and I am so excited about this foundation board of trustees. Some new faces, some new ideas, and I think we're gonna put some framework in the sand and in the ground so that we have continuity, long-term, a lot of structure that we can move forward so that the foundation also has a tremendous impact on the industry. Michelle Raftery, Dr. Paula Stamp, Joy Wu, Stacy Cunningham, and Sarah Kynard. Thank you so much for serving on the foundation board, and I'm really excited to work with you. SMPS Nebraska peeps, all of you, there was lots of people who helped with this submittal. Jeannie LeBron, Michelle Hilding, Stacy Odinas, Jeremy Merriweather, Lisa Kimmel, Mike Bank, Terry Hawley, Mimi True, Quinn Texmo. You all are my peeps, and you made me live my time in Nebraska. You know, it's been amazing. And the reason why I'm reading these names on the stage is that you have helped me, and I just get to be here today, but all of these relationships, all of these people have been very, you're contributing in many other ways to the profession that we have as well. So here's some random people from across the country. Loretta Flick, Lindsay Young, Colleen Cusera, Stephanie Munoz, Kelly Veit with ACEC Wisconsin, Bart Pugh, Amy Villasana Moore, Cricket Robertson, Beth Harris, Matt Barrows at University of Lincoln in University of Nebraska in Lincoln, where I've taught a class. Pauline Stark with SCORE Omaha. Dana Burks, Maria Stover at Washburn University, my alma mater, where I developed a class that really uses Domain 5. It's pretty fun. Patrick Jensen, Jeffrey Dorf, Melissa Rysak, Barbara Koldos. She was a member in Arizona, and she is now business development director in an economic development company in Northeast Ohio. She is an amazing woman. Keep an eye on her. She's amazing. Maddie Witt, Rebecca Timmer, Chris Gray, and Alicia Coladin. Y'all are amazing people and have done so much to help the profession. Special thanks to staff for all of your years of support. Michael, Tina, Marcy, Natalie, Kevin, Antonio, Matthew, Julio, Megan, Linda, and now Nandi, it's been so nice to meet you. And I love working with you, and hope I'm not going anywhere, so you're gonna have to stick with me. So then there's my family, and I have three children. Their pictures were in there. Rochelle's my daughter, Will, and then Charlie. And they went to work with me. They slept under the bed on a couple of occasions at least. But I'm so proud that they have seen, they understand marketing, and so it's amazing, you know, the ripple effect that we were talking about this morning. It's amazing to see it in my children. My parents, you saw their picture in there too. They're in their 90s. Health is kind of iffy, but they set a foundation for me as well and are part of the success. And then, of course, my amazing husband, Jerry, who has been with me on most of this 25-year journey, and I'm sure he's just chuckling inside because of all the things that we do. But I thank you so much for your time and your commitment and letting me do all this stuff. So thanks for being amazing friends, partners, colleagues, challengers. You make this work part of my life so important to me, and I think I'm living my vision of glorifying God through family, friends, faith, and work. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, come on this side. Oh, or you can go there. I need to read.
Let's hear it again for our great panel, and congrats to the 2022 Class of Fellows and Marketing Achievement Award recipient.
All right, so we won't keep you long. Just want to remind you about tonight's event at the World of Coca-Cola. Make sure you wear your fun and expressive neon.
There's examples.
There's
the
examples
front. Can
right
you
here.
Stand?
Can you please stand?
Okay.
A little bit of neon. A little
That's
bit of neon.
That's what we're looking for.
And don't worry, we'll be changing. Okay. We're giving you the fashion this week, okay? All right, so shuttles will be offered directly from the hotel to the venue starting at 7:30, and we'll go back and forth throughout the event. Please don't forget your name badges to get on the shuttles and into the venue. Return shuttles will run from 10 to 11, and for tomorrow, it's our last day. How do we even get here? Of Amplify AEC, and our first main stage event begins at 9 a.m. But first, there's breakfast at 7:30, and if you're early riser, we've got some sunrise yoga at 6:30 in the Zen Experience Room. Have a great rest of your day, and we'll see you at the World of Coca-Cola.
Bye, guys.